Welcome to My Stupid Podcast. My name is Angelo.
I'm Jeff.
And we are two John Mayer fans who have started a John Mayer podcast. And today we have a special episode for you out there. We're doing an interview with a friend of mine, an old friend of mine, singer-songwriter and John Mayer fan, David Ramirez out of Austin, Texas. So we just got done with interviewing him over Zoom, and it was a great time catching up and hearing him, hearing about his life and his art and being a musician in Austin and what that looks like. And then we even had a little John Mayer fun at the end. So yeah, it was a really, really good time. So real quick, we always say these things, right? You can find us on all the social media platforms, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. Just search My Stupid Podcast. You'll be able to find us. Go follow us there. If you really like the show and think it brings value to you, go leave us a review on iTunes or follow us or subscribe. Do all those things. 5-star review takes you a couple seconds to do. And if you're like, man, I really, really do like it, write a review. We would love to see those things. You can also write into the show, mystupidpodcastshow@gmail.com. We do read the emails and we love hearing from our listeners. We're going to skip the emails for today just to jump right into the interview. Jeff, what did you think of talking with David?
It was really insightful, especially getting his story on what it's like nowadays.
Yeah.
You know, as a working musician.
Yeah.
And also on a personal note, rather inspiring, because he was somebody that kind of, he didn't really have the same trajectory as me, but he was in the same place that I am at currently, physically, in Dallas, at a certain point in his life. And he took a path to, you know, becoming a working musician, while I was just like, it's too hard or whatever. I always quit everything. So, you know, it was just interesting seeing the parallels in my own life.
Such a sweet guy to give us his time. He just came out with a new record called My Love is a Hurricane. And if you haven't listened to it, you need to go stream it, buy it. You know, wherever you find music, you can find it. But we do encourage you to go support him. Supporting local artists is so great. And we are going to leave you with the track at the end of the interview. So make sure and stick around for that. We'll put a track. What do you want to put on there? Let's put I Want to Live in Your Bedroom.
Yeah, that's a great track. That's Mayer fans definitely respond to that one too.
So
it's kind of a gospel-y Mayer vibe. So
stick around after the interview to hear that track. I guess
definitely go listen to the album. You guys are gonna really dig it. It's got a great vibe. So
I think you definitely are. So without any further ado, here is the interview with David Ramirez. Hey everyone, we are here with Jeff and I are here with special guest David Ramirez, singer-songwriter David Ramirez. Say hi, David.
Hey, how's it going, everybody?
All right, and
one single person clapping.
That's right. David is a good friend of mine and an old friend, he's just released a new album, and we thought we'd have him on our podcast today just to talk about music, talk about him, his music, what's going on, how he's been doing, singer-songwriter stuff, what it's like being a working musician, all that kind of stuff. And then we will, because this is a John Mayer podcast, be talking about some John a little bit later. But
John Mayer. Yep.
John,
John Mayer,
John Mayer.
I guess that's how people say it. No one's like, yeah,
not to any concerts I've been to.
No,
like slow dancing comes on, and somebody
It's usually like, I love you, John.
Yeah,
that's usually decibel pitch, yes.
But, David has just released a new album called My Love is Hurricane. If you have not heard of this, if you are out there listening, who's David, go look him up. He's on Instagram, he's on all the different social media platforms where you can find him, and go check out his music. We're going to talk about that. So David, you're from Austin,
Texas. Well, this has been home for 12 years now, but I was born and raised in Houston. And don't be shy, Angelo, we're not just old friends, but my first band and my first bass player was you.
This is definitely true.
Humble Angelo. Come on.
I was not good. I still
you think
am not
I was good.
I'm still not good. I will I mean I'm not I'm okay at, I can fumble around a little bit on the bass and drums and guitar and stuff. Jeff is definitely a much better musician, as David is as well. But I like to, yeah, we were definitely former bandmates. That was a lot of fun. That was a lot of fun. We worked together.
And, we worked at a bookstore and Lifeway Christian Bookstore, and then had a band together, and you know, we were just kids having a good time.
That's right. Do you know that was like almost 20 years ago?
Yeah, I know. I think about it often, actually.
I think about that too. But
I missed 6 months ago. 20 years ago, dang.
I know. Yeah. 20 years ago, college, working and pretending, you know, that we were going to be that I was going to be in a successful band. Like that was like, I was like, oh, this could, you know, no, I was not good. I mean, it's just, oh my gosh. Anyway.
Do you guys at least have like a killer band name? Was it a,
yeah, we did.
Drew the audiences in. What are you, what was
David,
it?
Yeah, it was Together Since Sunday.
Together Since Sunday. It was a very 2000s
emo-esque
man,
band name.
If you guys could have gone on the road with Taking Back Sunday, oh,
well, that was it. You know, it was kind of
that's the dream,
dream lineup right there. Yeah.
It was a fun time, but David has definitely grown as a musician since then, and you know, and I have not. So, but
what genre was it?
It was just like
it was gospel music, you know, not gospel in the traditional sense, but yeah, it was mostly like songs about you know,
Christian
Christian-esque
type songs.
Oh, okay.
Acoustic
though, you were mentioning, Angelo, or
yeah, that's the style. That was style. You know, it was you know, we
basically wanted to be, or I wanted to be Dave Matthews. So
little baby, I totally get that.
Yeah.
Well, let's start there, David. You started playing music early. I mean, how old were you when you started playing?
17 was when 17. I first picked up guitar, yeah.
And
20 years ago.
Yeah,
to the date.
I mean,
yeah.
And why? Why'd you pick up the guitar? What started all that?
Well, my brother came home with the guitar, and you know, at the time I was a baseball player, and you know, so music to me was just something that came on the radio. It wasn't, you know, I had favorite bands and whatnot, definitely, but to actually achieve it or pursue it, that wasn't even on my radar. You know, I was an athlete, and you know, I was playing ball. But you know, I moved houses my senior year, or right before my senior year, so it was zoned to a different high school for my last year of high school, and the group of kids that I fell into. You know, walking around the cafeteria, like, who do I sit with? You know, I'm a new kid here at the school, and the kids that I happen to, you know, who were nice enough to invite the newbie to sit down and have lunch with them, they were all theater kids and choir kids. And based off their passions, you know, I kind of, that all kind of rubbed off of me. And then I remember my brother, right before that, you know, my old man took him out to Guitar Center and bought him a guitar, and I made fun of him at the time. And then when he wasn't in the house, I would find myself sneaking down to his room to try to figure out how to play this situation.
That's awesome. Yeah. Well, yeah. So you're in high school, you start fumbling around with the guitar, fast forward a couple years. And you know, when I met you, we were working at this bookstore together. And you were already starting to like perform. I mean, you were performing, you know, it was small coffee shops or, you know, in a church setting or something like that. But you were, you were already like writing music and performing when I met you in the year 2001. So, you know, what happened between then? Oh, man, I'm a athlete. I don't even really know how to pick up the guitar. And then fast forward a couple years. And you're writing songs, like you're performing, you're already, you know, I don't know if it was already, if you knew already that was what I was going to do, like that's what you're going to do. But what, you know, what made that transformation?
I don't know. Just being in love with being the center of attention. I mean, I think that's what really started. I mean,
yeah.
At age. Yeah. That sounds
you know, certainly, it's, it's grown, and I've become an adult, and I've seen the importance and the beauty of art and music and what it can do to an individual and what it can do to a room full of people. But yeah, at that age, you know, I was born and raised, I was the firstborn in my immediate family, and then I was the first grandchild on both sides of the family, you know, so I was born into the spotlight and totally spoiled. and as much as I loved baseball, I wasn't the star player, you know, and I was okay for what I did, but I wasn't the best. And then I found something that I happened upon it. And those kids that I, you know, met in the cafeteria my first day there, you know, they introduced me to theater and getting to, you know, I don't know, be an actor.
Yeah.
You know, and be on stage and, you know, people applauding you. I think at that age, it was really just about, you know, wanting attention. But I did enjoy the idea of writing songs, and I did enjoy attempting to write songs for sure. But, mm-hmm. you know, you're a kid, so you want to be seen. And I didn't really, I got bullied a bunch growing up, and this was an outlet for me. And
mention girls like it.
Yeah, as a 17-year-old, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. The chicks love it.
Big selling point, for sure.
Yeah.
Hey, if you can learn, you know, Crash Into Me by Dave Matthews Band.
That was the first song I learned. That's the first song I learned because of that. Yeah.
It's like, man, I can play this after school, you know, or, hey, y'all come over here, listen to me play. And
yeah, totally, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah, so, David, from then, you know, we started, you know, we were in a band together, and we were performing at places and doing stuff. And then you decided to move to Dallas, right? So from Houston, mm-hmm. things were just okay here. You moved to Dallas, and that's whenever I remember you really starting to kind of take off and become a little bit more serious
mm-hmm.
about your musicianship, getting definitely better musicians. in your group to play with you and do all that. Talk about, you know, Houston to Dallas and eventually Nashville, right? Mm-hmm. Didn't you spent some time in Nashville?
Yeah, not long. I was out there for about a year. Yeah.
Yeah. And in the midst of all that, kind of a ramp up, right? Like, this is all a ramp up to getting to Austin and really finding, I think, great success at that point, at least in my eyes. So talk about that, you know, I call you a working musician.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. And, I've heard people call them like blue collar musicians, like musicians, they make a living doing this.
Yeah.
You know, they're not rich and famous, you know, they don't have millions and millions, but they make a living. Like, they don't, you know, this is what they do. So talk about that. Talk about the transition between being able to like actually do this for a living and what it took to get there and kind of that journey.
Yeah, I mean that didn't really happen, you know, being full time until I moved here to Austin. You know, Dallas was great. You know, I was able to get kind of like my sea legs and, you know, get to actually play my first round of venues mm-hmm. for people other than my parents and people other than my friends, you know, where I was going to a small private college up there, you know, and so my name kind of got around this little campus, and that felt good. And, you know, and then I'd go play Deep Ellum in Dallas or Lower Greenville, and, you know, some of those students would come out to the shows and, you know, and actually pay like the $7 cover, you know, and then at the end of the night, you know, the promoter would come and give me, you know, a handful of cash, you know, and we'd split it between the band. And at that time it was like, oh my God, we each have $20, you know, and we're like, what the hell, this is crazy.
Yeah, we made some money.
We made money. Why are we getting paid $20 to do this? You know, this is awesome. And, you know, like, you know, a handful of cash that typically now I would scoff at. But, back then it was, you know, you just felt like the king of the world, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's kind of, you know, like I said, that's where I got my sea legs in Dallas. And then, you know, ego kind of took over, and I thought that I was, you know, the biggest news since sliced bread. And because, like I said, it was a small private university. of about 4,000 kids, and then, you know, if I can make it there, then I can make it anywhere, you know.
I can make it in Nashville, the city yeah. that has, you know,
yeah,
you
yeah.
throw a rock and hit a musician.
You yeah, know? Exactly. Elvis yeah. Presley, who? And but yeah, so, and I'm glad the ego took over, because otherwise I wouldn't have moved to Nashville, and that city definitely humbled me and made me, you know, it put me right in the middle of, like you said, working musicians. And they weren't just college kids who, you know, who a handful of kids, you know, had heard of, you know, it was, yeah. it was people who were trying to make a living, and people who had been doing it for a very long time, you know, so they knew how to craft a song and they cared about the craft. And, yeah, that town humbled me for sure. And, lost my job out there. And then I just hit the road. I was like, if I'm going to attempt to do this, I at least need a tour and try it out. And so I lived in my car for 6 months and just traveled the country. And, you know, it wasn't anything cool. It was like people's backyards or living rooms, or, you know, I'd play street corners or, yeah. open mics, you know, stuff like that. But I was just trying to figure out, what does it look like, you know? And if I were going to do this for a living, is it achievable? Is it possible? And that's kind of where it started. And then I came to Austin, and thankfully through all that experience, I, you know, I had a little confidence. And then I met this fella, Shane Wells, who's my manager and still is. And he wanted to manage me, and he kind of took it to the next level, you know? So
how'd you meet Shane?
I was doing a, you know, I had just come out with a record titled American Soil in 2009. And, oh geez, you're bringing back some memories, homie. you know, and I would do like 2 week tours or something like that. Super small, yeah. But I felt like I had tapped my audience. And, and around that time, that noise trade had just popped
off.
Noise trade. I'm not sure if that's still a thing, but this songwriter, Derek Webb, had launched this website mm-hmm. that you could put your record up there, pay what you want, or people could give you tips. And but what you would get as the musician in exchange were people's email addresses and zip codes, and so you could plan your tour around this. And so I threw the record up there for 48 hours to pay what you want, and or maybe it was just 24 hours, and I had 1,000 downloads. And for me at that time, 1,000 downloads was basically like getting $10,000, you know. It was mind blowing. Yeah. And I remember just being in my small little apartment there in Austin, like, oh my God, 1,000. And then I got an email a couple days later from my now manager, saying, who are you? I saw within 24 hours, a huge spike on the internet, and I just would like to sit down and chat with you and see you play. And that's how all that got started.
Man, I remember Noise Trade. And when that came out, like, you know, you think about music during that time, how people got music during that time. iTunes had been out for a little bit.
Sure.
People were still illegally downloading music. I mean, you know, they were using torrents or whatever to download music.
Right.
And then this was an opportunity for you to say, here, just take my music, have it for free. But I get very valuable information, right? It's actually not free. You're giving me, just like you said, email addresses and zip codes, which for a musician,
right,
that's gold.
It's gold and it's invaluable. And if people, you know, wanted to give you a dollar tip, they could, you know, but most people took for free. But, you know, and it sounds creepy, like, here's my record, I get your address, you know, like, but so I don't know about the kids listening today who are unfamiliar with Noise Trade. Everybody who was on the website was very aware and volunteered this information. It wasn't
That was the whole deal. And they were very I remember them being very transparent about it, about this is why we're giving the artist your, instead of money, we're giving them your email address and zip code so they can let you know when they're coming to play.
Absolutely. If they have a new record coming out, you know, and you could file all these things, you know, based off people's zip codes and know, okay, if I'm going to plan a tour, clearly no one in Wichita, Kansas is listening to me. So how about I bypass that town and I go, you know, I go to St. Louis instead, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah, definitely.
So yeah, but that's how the relationship with my manager got started. And
that's super cool, man. Yeah, so he just kind of reached out to you by seeing the success of Noise Trade, and from there it was like, that was it.
Yeah, that's yeah. Cool. I mean, he reached out. I mean, but you know, at that time, I think people could see that I had talent. I mean, granted, I wasn't the songwriter I am today, but you know, I was serious about it, and and I was trying my best to stay busy. So, you know, people would reach out constantly, like, "Do you have management? I'd love to manage you." And most of these people were just, you know, full of shit. Excuse my language.
That's
and,
all right. Yeah.
And
it's like me reaching out to you and being like, "Hey, could I manage you?" You know, it's like, "Well, who have you managed?" Nobody, but I think I could do it.
Totally. And
also, you owe me money for that. Yeah.
Yeah. And just the thought that you could do it, they're like, 10 grand up front. And I'm like, "Do you realize what's happening here?" Like, and so when I did get that initial email from Shane, and I love him to death now. He's not just my manager. We've become really, really just the closest of friends. And but I remember getting that email, and I'm like, "Oh, here's another dude." That's okay. Right. And so I called him because he left his phone number in the thing. And I remember very explicitly being like, "What do you want from me?" You know, like, yeah, me saying that to him, like, "Are you just another guy that's going to get, like, you want $10,000 up front? Like, what do you do? I'm looking at your website here," you know, that kind of thing. And he explained himself, and he sounded legitimate, and then came to watch me play. He bought me a beer, and then he was like, "I'll work for you for free for 2 years." And then after 2 years, that's when my commission was started. And I was like, "What the hell? This guy's amazing."
That's awesome. Yeah.
Yeah,
this that's a golden awesome ticket, man.
Yeah, yeah, totally. And it all worked out. But yeah, there were so many people that were like, "I'll manage you. Call your parents and ask them for $30,000 and wire it to me right now." Yeah.
Well, it's like the, yeah, I mean, it sounds,
I've seen
so
that.
Scammy.
I've seen that myself, yeah. Yeah, with my music. Like, I released my first album in 2013, and like, for one of the first emails I got was like, "Yeah, dude, we'll totally promote your music." And it was like three emails later, they were like, "Just sign this form." And at the bottom, it's like, "You owe us $7,000. Like,
yeah, yeah, yeah. No, thanks.
And,
what?
And 90% of everything.
They'll string you along. Make,
yeah, it's yeah, like, yeah. It reminds me of those scam calls that, you know, like old people get.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, "Hey, you know, you need to, your grandson's in jail. We need $10,000 to... to release them, you know, to get them out and bail." They're like, "Okay, yeah, here, take the money." You know, it's like,
yeah, take the money.
Yeah, geez Louise, man, that sucks that there's people. You know, let's talk a little bit about that, because, you know, there may be people listening. I know a lot of our listeners are songwriters and like musicians, mm-hmm, and maybe they're trying to get up and coming. Just because a lot of John Mayer's fans are they naturally,
yeah, they're songwriters. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Being, you know, I don't want to say like, "What are your three keys to success as a working musician, David Ramirez?" But you know, but what are, you know, what are some things, you know, what would you say helped you along the way? And we're not just talking luck. I mean, there's some of it that's just kind of like, oh, the timing, right? Some of it is timing. Some of it is you just get introduced to the right person at the right time. But what would you say has been like one of your, "Hey man, I know I did this. I was engaged in this activity or this kind of attitude or whatever, and that's what I know has been a key to me getting to where I am right now."
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure so many people have said this before, but yeah, I just never stopped ever. I never stopped. And it wasn't like this weird, like Michael Jordan situation of like, "I have to be the best." I'm just so in love with the craft. I'm obsessed with it. And yeah, it would be really cool to be the Michael Jordan of songwriters, you know, one day. I think that'd be really dope, but
at least the Scottie Pippen of songwriters.
Dude, I'll take Pippen any day, dude. Pippen's dope. And, I'm just that obsessed with it. I find it to be the most therapeutic thing. I think I'm firmly aware of who I am at any given moment and any given conversation. I know exactly what I'm doing and who David Ramirez is because I've spent time staring myself in the mirror to write these songs.
Yeah.
And, And I think that's the beautiful thing about songwriting is, you know, no matter what the subject is or the lyrics, I think you have to sit yourself down and ask the question, like, who am I? You know, and if you're just, even if you're writing a song about, you know, heartbreak or whatever, well, you have to ask, well, who am I and what do I believe about love and in order for me to write this song? And I'm just obsessed with that process. And so, yeah, if you love it, you're going to know it for sure. But even if you don't and you want to be just really good at it because you have that, you know, Michael Jordan mentality, you can't stop, really. No matter what anybody says or no matter how much shit you go through, just keep writing.
Yeah.
You know, and just keep doing it. But I think that was it for me. And, you know, the few people who have stuck with me and stayed in my corner, I think they see that this dude's not going to stop. Like, he's very, very addicted to this thing. So if we can count on one thing, maybe his talent won't always be there. But he'll keep working. He'll keep working. Yeah, for sure.
That's awesome.
I actually would love to be Exhibit A of what not to do as a songwriter, because I was in the same situation. I mean, you were in Dallas for a period, but I've been here like my whole life.
Still. You're in Dallas now?
Yeah, yeah. Okay. And I've played all those venues that you've mentioned, whether in a band or solo.
Right.
And I stopped. That's, you can't. You can't stop. I
mean, you can't stop.
Exactly. Yeah. And then you have to take risks too, because you took risks. You went to Nashville, and then after that you mentioned living in your car. That's a huge risk.
Yeah,
to just be like, I'm just going to go on the road.
Yeah, absolutely.
People need to, that want to be serious about it, have to show that they're serious about it, for sure.
Yeah, I agree. You know, but we also live in this day and age where, you know, I don't think people understand, you know, the younger folks, they don't understand the idea of a work ethic. And, I can just sit in my room and make a YouTube video. And, you know, if I start the YouTube video with a prank, then it'll go viral, you know. And
right, right.
And I'm like, well, I mean, that's cool and creative and whatever, but, you know, there's got to be some kind of appreciation for the tradition of it all, you know. And
I agree.
But you know, at the end of the day, it's all motivation too. Like, what are you in it for? And if you're trying to get viral, then there's a reason for it. But if you're really doing it because you love the craft, then that's going to show as well.
So, I love that you just talked about the youngins.
The youngins, yeah, Jesus
Christ. The TikTok gen,
Have I reached the age where I say youngins?
You're just like, you're like these youngsters, you know, these young whippersnappers out here
kids
thinking that
days,
they can
man.
Just kids
yeah.
these days, you know? It's
yeah.
I mean, I'm younger than you guys, and I'm even like, these young people, I have no idea what they're doing out there now. It's just.
Yeah. I find myself Googling, like, what does SMH stand for? Oh, shaking my head. Okay.
Yeah, I didn't know what it stood for. I didn't know what it stood for a really long time, and I finally had to look it up.
Yeah, I'm like Googling all these terms or whatever.
Same here.
I still feel like I'm, you know, woke AF, but you know, because I keep up with culture because it's obviously part of my job, but, you know, right, there's stuff going on these days.
You let it show in your songs, though. You're not like, set, you know, viral tweet, retweet, whatever.
Yeah,
it's
yeah,
not just
sure.
one sentence and then you're done for the day.
Yeah, for sure. But there is a lot that I'm not hip to anymore. And it's, those kiddos.
Isn't, you know, it's funny. I remember talking to someone about TikTok and realizing I work at a church, but I also do a lot of marketing for small businesses and stuff like that. So I'm in the know of like social media and all that kind of stuff. Like fairly, like, I mean, pretty good. I'm not gonna lie.
I'm
basically the best. Okay, but when
well, we're gonna switch this interview around. Angelo, when did you begin your career?
Michael Jordan but, of
that's right. I'm the Michael Jordan. By the way, obsessed with The Last Dance. I don't know if you've watched it yet, but you.
Oh yeah,
I got two more episodes to go, but I'm obsessed with it.
I'm on my second viewing of it.
Yeah, I was gonna say you'll want to watch it again when you finish. God. You'll be like, it's over. Oh.
I can't believe it. I'm floored constantly.
Me too. I'm just like, I sit there and I go, because I wasn't into basketball. Like, I've never been into that, been into sports, really. I wasn't ever into that. Yeah. So then I look at this, and I'm like, I cannot believe I lived through this and didn't know what was happening. Like, I had known.
I'm not trying to pour salt in your wounds, but I watched those games. Oh, you know, they're showing highlights. Yeah. And I called my dad two nights ago. He was, you know, I saw that he was up on Instagram. He liked a photo of mine or something, and it was like 3 in the morning. So I call him and I'm sitting on my back patio, you know, pouring another tequila, and we're just geeking out. I'm like, remember that one game when I was 13 and the Bulls, you know, were playing the Suns, and he got that last, you know. He's like, yeah, I can't believe you remember that. I'm like, it was Michael Jordan. Like, the whole world was watching. But
that's right.
Apparently, yeah. Angelo Gonzalez was not, you know.
No, I was definitely not watching.
I might have been, but I was like six. I don't remember. That was like 93, yeah. 94, right? So
yeah, yeah.
So, yeah. In 93, 94, I was watching a lot of Nickelodeon. Let's just put it that way.
Oh,
same.
Sure. Yeah,
I wasn't into sports or anything like that. But anyway.
Rocco's
okay.
Yeah. Modern Life.
There you go. Yeah.
Yeah.
This is a John Mayer podcast, not a Michael Jordan podcast. But
soon to be a Michael Jordan podcast.
Yeah, so we're going to start our Michael Jordan podcast after this. But so, David, I want to bring it to now. You just released an album. We're in the middle of a pandemic.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you just released an album.
Yeah, super smart.
You're not alone, though. You're not alone.
No. I mean,
well, successful,
you know,
doing that.
A little artist. So. I don't know if you've heard of this artist named Taylor Swift, but she released an album as well.
Yeah.
Little known.
The first, though, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Little known singer-songwriter, you know. But
sure.
Never heard
how
of her.
Has it been? What's been, you know, since... What is it like being a working musician right now where bars and venues are closed? Like they, you know, you how many summer tours were canceled this year? You know, I mean, so many summer tours, so many. And a lot of these people, you know, I listen to some other podcasts and they talk about, you know, techs and road crew and venue people who are just like so hurting right now because you know their lifeblood is gone. They're, you know, where they get their income from. But what's it like being a musician during COVID-19?
Yeah, I mean it's hard not to take it personally.
What do you mean by that?
It's not personal. It's hard not to be selfish in this. And
I see.
And yeah, where you're like, you know. The world is hurting. The world's on fire, literally. And, you know, and yeah, I don't get to play. I don't get to do what I enjoy out of this life the most, you know. And, you know, you only get one life to live. And so what are you going to do with it? And I chose what I want to do with it. And that has been, you know, stripped away from so many of us during this time.
Yeah.
But for me now... you know, because there were a lot of talks, you know, with the label and management, like, do we release the record this year during all this, or do we stay on track to stick with the release date, or do we push it until all this is over?
Yeah.
And I couldn't live with myself if I made this all about me, and people still listen to music, and
and
I worked really hard on this thing, and I didn't just work on this thing so that I could further my career. I worked on this thing because I love it so much. And let's stick with the date and let's put it out. And if it hurts us in the long run, then it hurts us in the long run. And you know what? I'm going to make another record. And, but I feel now it's really important to put beautiful things into the world and things that you believe in into the world. And, because we all need it. And, I need the release, and I'm not saying people need my music. What I am saying, though, is that I think people need to see that the creative heart of the humanity has not shut down just because we can't be together. The creative heart of humanity is still pumping, and it is still working, and it is still alive and well. And so here's my record, and it's something I believe in, and I love it, and I hope you like it. But I'm not waiting until the world is back to quote-unquote normal, dude.
Right.
To do things, but it is difficult. You know, I can't tell you how many, you know, just to divulge honesty to the audience, you know, I canceled last week because I was just in a dark place. And, you know, I find myself waking up sometimes and just in tears because I miss people so much, but you know, what are you going to do? You wait it out, you stay strong and you stay creative and you know, by golly, if you have a record put out, then put it out and don't wait for anything because the world's passing us by. And so just remind people that, you know, the creative heart of humanity is still alive and well. Just because we can't be together doesn't mean that has shut down also, you know.
That's great.
Beautiful sentiment.
Let's talk about the record because it is a beautiful record.
Thank you.
I did pre-order it, so I have it on vinyl.
Nice.
And did the little download. I got the little download card with it and put it on my phone. So listening to that a lot on the road, just where I'm driving. And then nice. I put it on this morning just to kind of listen to it again with some fresh ears. So let's talk about this album. You said fifth studio album.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct? Fifth studio album.
That is correct, yeah.
And the sound is actually kind of very different from what you've done in the past. Let's talk about that. Talk about kind of what would you call it, the genre of music you do, David? I'm sure. I bet you could ask this, and you're like, "I'm not sure." Go ahead.
All the time. Yeah, all the time. It's. I mean, clearly, I'm a songwriter, but every record's different. You know, I've put out records that are very Americana. Put out records mm-hmm. that kind of dipped its toes in country music, and
yeah,
and I think the one I put out before this kind of dipped its toes in some rock and roll, and I don't know, I'm a songwriter, but I know that's not a genre, but it's
that's all right. You know, that's all right.
But it's a thing. But
our guy, John Mayer,
yeah,
is not a genre person either. So yeah, that's, you know, when we talk a lot about that on the podcast, it's just like, well, he's put out this kind of record, and then he changed his sound over here, and then he went this way, and you know, genres I think definitely meld together, and there's you know. But what, talk about this record. Where'd this record come from? What's you know, when did you start recording it? Talk about the songs and you know, what the sentiment of this whole record is about.
Yeah, for sure. I started this record in October of 2018. And typically in the past, you know, every album I've done, you know, maybe 2 or 3 weeks in the studio.
Okay.
I mean, that excludes the time beforehand writing the songs and whatnot. But the studio time, you know, I keep it brief because of budget constraints. And then I never really thought to spend longer than that. You know, I'd hear stories that Coldplay spent 2 years in the studio. And I'm like, that sounds stupid, you know? And, but I knew I wanted to work with this fella out of Dallas named Jason Burt. And, I was kind of getting tired of writing in the way that I had written before, which was just by myself in my bedroom with an acoustic guitar.
So is that typically how you did it in the past? You, like, you wrote the songs and you brought them in, and we're like, okay, here they are. Let's put them together.
These are the parts, you know, don't play over my lyrics. And then, you know, we track for 2 weeks and then we call it a day. It was all pretty simple. And this one was simple too. We just spread it out, and I wanted to collaborate a lot more. And so I would show up with an idea like, you know, I have a chorus, but I don't know what the verse is going to be. And so, you know, we'd all just sit down together and do something. And it was the most collaborative thing I've ever done in my life. And I'm not sure I'm ready right now to go back to writing exclusively alone. And that's not to say there aren't songs in this record that I exclusively wrote by myself, but the idea behind this album was just bringing people together. And then so we collaborated, and I think that shows, you know, I think my voice still, you know, is still there. The heart of who Ramirez is definitely evident, but
yeah,
I mean, this doesn't sound like anything I've ever done, because to be honest with you, I'm not capable of doing this on my own. That's the answer.
Wow.
I don't have what it takes to put this record together by myself.
That's cool. It definitely doesn't. When I, you know, when you released, I think you released Lover Will You Lead Me like at the beginning of the year, just kind of as a, you know, you released it on YouTube or something, or Apple Music.
Yeah.
And I remember I was actually driving to Austin. This was the last trip I took, with my family. We were driving to Austin to visit some family there. And I saw you released it, and I was like driving in the van, and I saw it, and I downloaded it in the van so I could listen to it.
Oh, nice.
And I listened to it, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is different.
Yeah.
You know, I wasn't expecting this.
Sure.
And pleasantly surprised, you know, listened to it a few times and on that car trip. And then, you know, obviously was looking forward to, well, I guess there's new music on the horizon.
Yeah.
And that was coming out. But this album, Man, this album's really good.
Dude. Thank you.
It's a killer album, yeah. I binged, like, not binge, but repeat listening all last week. I just couldn't stop, dude. It was so
Thank you so much.
Yeah. I feel like it tells a story. Is that accurate?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, contextually, as far as lyrics go, I wanted to, you know, my last record had some politically charged songs on it.
Yeah.
And as I was writing for this new record, I found myself kind of sticking in that camp, you know, and then I just kind of, I put it down. I think at the time it was just too easy to talk shit about, you know, our president, you know, it's everywhere you look, it's just negativity and rightly so. I mean, I don't believe in the fella at all, and I don't think anyone's comments are unwarranted, but I was just finding myself just so creatively uninspired, because how do I write a song that I could literally just take the words from CNN or Twitter or Instagram?
Yeah.
And
that's not
creative. That's not creative to me. So I purposely set out to write a song or write a record that was all positive. And I had just recently fallen in love with this wonderful woman, and I said, I'm writing this record about our relationship, and it's 100% about my heart and how full of life it is currently, and I just wanted to put something positive in the world, and I'd never done a love record. Most of my songs dealing with relationships are how they end.
Challenging and long distance stuff like that.
Yeah, totally, yeah. For sure. And I wanted to, you know, tip my cap to all the great love records out there in the world, and contribute, you know, my two cents. And so, but you know, now I'm fed up. So the next record's going to be real fucked up. But so
can't wait.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, for sure. It's not, you know, I got the love record out, and the next one's going to be pretty gnarly, but I'm
metal.
Pretty excited.
Can't wait for your metal album.
That's right.
Yeah, it'll be total death metal for sure.
Lots of growls and, you know,
drop
D and drop C tuning.
I'm thinking more gnarly, like Tom Waits, where I growl, but in that way, you know?
Yes.
Life is a river of misery. Everybody row. Everybody row. Everybody row.
So there's a lot of cool, man. There's so many cool grooves in this album.
Yeah.
Talk about that. Talk about the different. I mean, you have a lot of different instruments happening in this album.
Sure.
A lot of different sounds. You know, some of your other albums are fairly straightforward in that, you know, it's a kind of a traditional, you know, either folk sound or
Americana. Just,
yeah, Americana. Yeah. But Jeff, what did you say when we were talking about this?
Well, yeah, I actually did have a question about the evolution of your sound you can kind of hear the evolving, like you mentioned with your last record from 3 years ago to, you know, you're kind of playing with more instruments, more different sounds and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So like, did you go in, I know that you mentioned that there was a more collaborative process in this one, but did you go in going like, okay, maybe the genre should be leaning more towards like, cause you have a lot of soul and R&B elements in this record.
Absolutely.
I was curious if you went into it going, we're going to make it, you know, have all these grooves sound like R&B.
Absolutely.
Soul.
Yeah. The R&B gospel elements that are laced all throughout this record were very intentional. The fellow who produced the record is a good friend of mine out of Dallas. His name is Jason Burt. And for all you kiddos out there, you can find him at Electrofunk on Instagram.
All right. But that kind of, you know, that sounds like you could. Hey, what genre is this? Is My Love Is a Hurricane? Electrofunk.
Electrofunk. Yeah, absolutely. Good.
That's also the handle of the.
Yeah, the guy who helped that's the guy. Yeah, totally. No, you're not wrong. He wrote a song. I guess it was early 2018, and we had known each other and we had crossed paths, but we weren't homies, you know. And he called me one day, and he's a great musician and he's a great songwriter, but he doesn't he's not a fan of his voice. And so he's been writing these songs and bringing people in to sing these songs. Mm-hmm. So he wrote a tune called Blue Magnolia. And he was like, I'm coming down to Austin. I wrote this tune. I want you to come in and sing it. And I'm like, absolutely. You should sing me the song. And it's just beautiful. It's just so well written. And I went out to a studio out in Dripping Springs, just west of the city. And I walk in, and all he had tracked by at this point was just acoustic guitars. And yeah. He'd done like a scratch vocal. And so I go in there and I do my part and I sing the song. And then my part's done, and I'm kind of hanging around just watching them work or whatever. And then he, you know, pulls out his drum pad and he starts putting this electronic beat on it. And then he pulls out this bass, and he's not just playing the chords. He's like actually doing a groove.
Yeah.
And I was like, whoa, you can do this with folk tunes?
That's awesome.
Okay. And I'm pretty sure, I mean, I was probably stoned.
Like,
but
you're like processing it right there in the moment.
Right,
like,
there.
Maybe I'm going to play with this.
Yeah, I was like, you want to do my next record?
That's awesome. So that's all the fun, kind of strange synthy instruments, is like the drum pad type stuff.
Absolutely. That's, I mean, so we did play with, you know, and there's a real drummer, Amber Baker, and she's one of the best I've ever had a pleasure of meeting and playing with. But, you know, laced underneath all her parts, we did have a lot of electronic beats. And there's a lot of electronics on this. And I agree with you, Angelo. When people ask what the genre of this record is, I should say it's electro-funk.
That's hilarious, yeah.
And he's actually had the opportunity to play with John Mayer, actually one-on-one in a studio session. Jason Burt. Yeah, we should just give him a shout-out. Jason Burt works with Leon Bridges as well, and Leon and John are good friends. And so that song, John Mayer wasn't originally supposed to be on it. It was just a Leon thing, and Jason's producing that track. And he's like, "You mind if John Mayer comes?" He's like, "Do I mind?" Yeah, like, he's like, "Yeah, bring the dude in." And so he shows up and he plays guitar on it and sings on it. But I don't think that was the original plan. And
wow,
and I was like, dude, how was it hanging with John? He was like, it was dope as hell. Like, it was like, so tight.
It's exactly what you thought it would be. Amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. He was like, it was pretty tight, dude. Yeah.
That's awesome. Wow. Look at that. We got a David Ramirez, John Mayer connection right here.
Yeah. We just went full circle on your asses.
That's right. Yeah.
What is that, 2 degrees, 3 degrees separation?
That's 1 degree, dude.
1 degree? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Because 0 degrees would be there.
Oh, okay. Yeah, right? Gotcha. All right.
1 degree is...
What about 98 and 6 degrees?
Yeah.
Separation.
98 and 6 degrees of separation.
Yeah.
Sorry. That's such a bad lyric. I'm sorry, man. Like, I just... Which is why he doesn't sing it. I know that's why he doesn't sing it, because he looks back at that lyric and he's like...
And he's just like, whatever, you're just gone now. You're gone, gone.
Yeah.
Wait, lyric is that?
Come Back to Bed on Heavier Things.
Oh,
he sings 98 and 6 degrees of separation, and it's like,
you're starting
to get above. I know what you're going for, John. You're really good with catchy, like funny, quirky lyrics. This is
he's clever, for sure.
So, what's your favorite song on this album right now?
On David's album, I saw the cover. I did a cover of it. Yeah, it's I Want to Live in Your Bedroom, that song.
Yeah, I saw that last week. Yeah,
oh,
thank
cool.
you. Yeah.
I was listening to that
so
one today,
good,
man.
I wanted to ask, actually, what's your favorite track would be to show people that, like, are like, oh, cool, you got new stuff? What's the new album sound like? What's, like, your favorite one to show people?
Yeah, well, I mean, I agree with you. I think I Want to Live in Your Bedroom is one of the sweetest and most romantic and well-written songs I've ever written. I'm very proud of that song. But, you know, if I were to like, hey, I have a new record out, and I started playing that one, it's pretty obvious it's a Ramirez tune, you know? So I like to shock them with this record.
Yeah.
And so the one that I put on first for people is track number 2, Hell. Because I think sonically it's just one of the coolest things. I think it blends genres really well. And then obviously one of my dear friends, Kelsey Wilson, who's in this band called Sir Woman. She's the front woman of that band. She takes the third verse, and her voice is just so beautiful. And I think it's a sexy tune. I think it's upbeat and, you know, rocking at times. And
yeah, I was going to say there's a lot of rock elements in that one.
Yeah, that's the one I go to when people are like, show me a new track. I'm like, you're about to find out, dude.
That's definitely a departure for sure. Angelo, what was you might have been about to answer. What's your favorite from the?
I think right now it's I Want to Live in Your Bedroom.
I was
hearing it this morning and it was on. I mean, literally about an hour ago it was on. Well, a little over an hour because we've been talking for an hour. It was. I was really enjoying it. I was here in my bedroom, kind of doing some stuff and.
Living in your bedroom.
I was living in my bedroom while I was listening. I Want to Live in Your Bedroom.
Yeah, I'm really proud of that song, and I appreciate y'all saying that. That's the one point of contention that Jason and I found ourselves in, because he has such an incredible vocabulary for music, and he wanted to take that song to like this crazy world, and I just wasn't having it. I was like, this is a song that I wrote all by myself that I believe in firmly needs to be simple. And honest, and it needs to be personal and intimate. And we can't be having all these crazy things going on this song. You know,
every other song, let's do that on some other songs.
Balls to the wall.
A good time. Go play, you know, on the playground. But this one, I gotta keep very sweet and intimate.
You can definitely see it in like a love scene on a CW show or something. It just oozes sex.
Oh yeah, give me Cameron Crowe at least, not CW. All right,
you know.
Give me Jerry Maguire. Fuck.
That's a good point, Jerry Maguire. Okay, that's a good
point.
Hey,
this would be
One Tree Hill.
I was about to say this would be really good as a episode 5 of season 3 of the OC.
Yeah.
Hey man, don't knock the OC. It's a good show, except season 3 is not that good. All right, I'll let that one slide.
Go ahead.
Oh no, you go ahead, please.
Oh, every time I hear the OC, I think of Arrested Development because it takes place in Orange County, and one of the characters says, "Yeah, that's one of the benefits." I forget what the quote is, but he's like, "That's one of the benefits of living in the OC." And then Michael Bluth, Jason Bateman's like, "Don't call it that."
Nobody calls it that.
Don't call it that.
I was I just thought of a question because. I feel like John Mayer's sound as a guitarist would be amazing on I Want to Live in Your Bedroom. Do you have a song that you would love for John to play on, of one of yours?
Oh, yeah. Man, it's such a bummer, this pandemic, for a lot of reasons. People, you know.
I know, because you would have been able to call him. Like, if not for the pandemic, you would have been able to.
Well, I just had so many plans for the tour, you know. It was going to be an incredible spectacle for sure. But I had to restrain myself on that song specifically because at the end, you know, when the chorus vocals come in and it just repeats.
Reverb, yeah.
I really wanted to launch into like a Purple Rain situation.
I can hear it in my head.
And so whenever the day comes, sorry to ruin the surprise, everybody, you know, the 10 people who were looking forward to a Ramirez record or tour, but I'm definitely, we're going to take that song to like, we're going to try our best, fingers crossed, to
I can hear that becoming like a
go to
like
Prince territory.
Minute, yeah, 7 minute, 8 minute jam in the live show.
Well, I'll put in a personal text to John and
please.
Yeah, we know him personally. Obviously. He named the podcast, obviously.
Yeah, I'll let him know that you want him on his record. Want him on this song, especially live. I'll make sure
on tour.
You know, he may on tour. I'll make sure he's a guest musician every stop.
Absolutely,
he'll come in and just play on this song. That's it.
I just meant hypothetically if you could possibly make that happen and the stars align somehow,
so
you could pick one song. That's all.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
So let's talk a little, John, since we're kind of in there right now. Let's talk a little bit. How has, you know, when we were talking earlier, like a couple weeks ago, David, you were like, I'm a huge John Mayer fan. And whenever we were in a band together, right?
Yeah.
John Mayer's just getting started, right?
I think Heavier Things had just dropped, like when you and I started.
Both obsessed with like John Mayer, Dave Matthews, Jason Mraz.
Same.
You know, all those guys who were, you know, just it was that time. And so let's talk about your John Mayer story, like kind of like you're on, how did you get on board with John? Like, if you can talk a little, you don't may not remember exactly, but when'd you first hear him? And
it was Room for Squares for sure. Yeah, it was my senior year in high school, definitely. And actually, I think the first song I ever heard of him, and this is just purely coincidental, is My Stupid Mouth.
Yeah.
And it was the acoustic version, not the Room for Squares version. And I remember my buddy Clint Petronella, we were cruising around in the car one day, and he asked me if I had ever heard of this fella. And I hadn't, and he played me that song, and I just thought it was the most clever song I had ever heard in my life. And I geeked out about literally every line, and it was on repeat and on repeat. And he's like, and then I, you know, start looking him up or whatever. And then,
yeah,
I guess that was the EP he put out.
Inside Wants Out was the first EP before Room for Squares. Yeah.
Yeah. And then the full length came out, and I fell in love with that record, a whole bunch.
Am I making this up that we went and saw him in Austin together, John Mayer?
You're not making it up.
We did that, right?
Yeah, we did that. I drove down. I was living in Dallas at the time, and I think you had an extra ticket and invited me. And we sat on the floor. We watched him like maybe 10 rows back.
Yeah. Wow. It was at the Frank Irwin Center.
Mm-hmm.
And it was me, you, and another lady who shall not be named since it's not my wife, and a friend, and two friends.
I brought a girl down from Dallas.
Okay, that's right. Yeah. Because it was four of
the
us.
Worst.
Yeah. And we went. Man, I totally forgot you were with me at that show.
Yeah,
I just remembered that right now.
Yeah, we saw him together, and
that was the Heavier Things tour.
It was the Heavier Things tour, and I think he had started playing some, you know, and he had reached the point now where, you know, someone's in the back handling all his gear, you know. And,
yeah,
I think one of his pedals had kind of malfunctioned, and just the grace in which he handled the situation, I found really impressive. You know, he was a professional, and at that point, I was just getting my feet wet, you know, starting to play things. And then every show I'd play, something inevitably went just terribly wrong. You know? And I just remember, that's the one thing I'd take away from that show, is the first time I saw him, is like his pedals were messing up and he made some little joke and then boom, he was back into it. And I was like, I need to be more like that for sure.
Yeah.
So has he, you know, I wrote, how has John Mayer influenced you? I don't know if he has or not, if he's a huge influence on you and your songwriter or anything like that. But, you know, what do you like about him? What do you like about how he writes or his music or his playing or anything like that? What's your...
Yeah, I think his way to turn a phrase is, I mean, he's one of the best in the business for sure. He's very clever, but I wouldn't say that he has a direct influence in my music. I don't think I have a single thing that someone would hear and be like, oh yeah, he likes John Mayer. But
I
respect that dude so much. And I think a lot of the reason why I write the way I do is because of songwriters like John, who write from a very personal and, hard on the sleeve place.
Yeah.
And, I'm not one of these writers who, you know, can make up a fictional story and sing it like it's real. You know, I've attempted that, and I just lack the ability to do that.
Yeah.
So the songwriters that I really subscribe to are the ones like John, who I'm hearing the song and I'm like, that's his life right there. And it's super tight.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sometimes John gets a bad rap.
Okay. Sometimes.
What do you say to the haters who are like, oh, John Mayer, you know,
Daughters,
your body is
Wonderland,
a Wonderland
guy,
or he's overrated, or you know, what do you know? Do you what? Because I have people like that in my, you know, they're just like, oh, you like John Mayer, you know, he sucks or whatever, and I'm like,
yeah, especially now that I share links to the podcast, it's like, oh, that guy who sucks, yeah, that's great that you're doing a podcast.
Ah, yeah, it's such a bummer. Well, I'm such a nerd about things that if somebody says like, "Oh, that guy or that girl or that movie sucks," I'm like, "Well, get over here right now. We're listening to it." You know, like
that's right. Yeah.
I'm like, "Well, clearly you haven't heard this song." You know, we'll be at a bar or something, and I'm like, "Get, we're leaving. We're going on a drive." Because clearly, right.
Get in the car.
Get in the car right now.
We're putting
now.
Continuum on front to back. Yeah. You need. Yeah.
I would just literally put on, because especially in high school where people would be more combative. I was in high school at the time Your Body's Wonderland came out, by the way.
Yeah.
And Heavier Things, but I would be more combative then about, you know, my opinion on John. That I would just be like, just shut your mouth and listen to Neon and Inside Once Out. Just shut your mouth and listen to that. Because then they hear it and they can't make sense of what they're hearing. They're like, what is he doing on the guitar? I've never heard a sound like that before, dude.
Sure. Well, I think it kind of has come back around.
He's
clearly stood the test of time. Yeah. He's clearly made a name for himself as someone who just works their ass off. And so, yeah, I think in high school and early college, if I brought up his name, people would, you know, maybe, you know, complain or ask why I listen to this dude. But, you know, more and more, like, you know, the most pretentious of musicians that I find myself next to from time to time, you know, if his name comes up right now in 2020, they're like, yeah, that dude's pretty good, actually. You know, so,
he's been on so many other people's tracks too. They're like, oh yeah, that's right. He was the guy on Leon Bridges' track too.
And you know, he's not the daughter's guy anymore.
No.
And it's a great song, and I do love that track a whole bunch. But he has been so creative and so versatile and dynamic that he's just John Mayer, and he's not the Bodies in Wonderland fella, you know, these days. So thankfully, I don't have to defend myself very often like I did in college. But
we're having a hiccup here. Are you getting that, Jeff?
Yeah, I'm getting that.
Oh, can you hear me?
No, we're back.
Yeah, now you're back.
We are back.
It was super slow-mo and then nothing.
Yeah, we're back.
Okay, all right. Cool.
That's okay.
Yeah, but anyway, just to repeat myself, it's I don't have to defend myself as much as I used to in college. I think people are...
Yeah. I think
whether they have been affected with love for him or not, the respect is definitely there.
Well, yeah, that's true. Definitely have been obsessed since I have, at least since
same.
Yeah, since Room for Squares and
same here.
So real quick, two just kind of off the cuff questions, and then we're gonna move into something that I like to call Mayer Madness, but real quick before we get into that, favorite album, favorite song right now of anyone, not just John, but anyone.
Oh, of anyone.
Yeah. Just, hey man, right now. And it's just, you know, not all time.
What you're
feeling
at the moment.
This isn't my favorite of all time. This is what I'm really feeling right now.
Okay. Favorite one right now is, Multitudes off Dylan's new record. Bob Dylan's new record is the first track's called Multitudes. And the first time I heard it, I was like, oh, he's referencing Walt Whitman right here. And Walt Whitman has a quote, do I contradict myself? Surely I do. I am large. I contain multitudes. And the song is just really well written and pisses me off because that's my favorite quote. And I should have wrote that fucking song, you know, but
now you can't.
Now
you cannot. Yeah.
He snuck it out of me, but it's really, really clever and it's really great. And so currently right now, that's the one that I have on repeat.
Cool.
Yeah.
Sweet. Well, we're going to move into Mayer Madness. David, you told me that your favorite two albums, if you were to pick like two, would probably be like Room for Squares and Continuum, right? Like those are probably like two of your top studio albums,
albums.
Yeah. When we talk about, you know, we've done this multiple times where we've kind of ranked stuff and we have to leave Where the Light Is out of everything we do because that would just like blow everything out of the water.
It's the number one thing ever.
Yeah. When we talk about like, best solos or best tracks or anything like that, it's like we have to leave that out because it's not fair.
Yeah. It's not fair.
So what I've done is I have created a bracket. You can see it right here.
Oh, tight.
A bracket. Okay. This is Mayer Madness, and I've pitted Continuum songs.
I see what you're doing.
Against Room for Square songs. Okay, and I didn't just throw them in here. This is all like there's math behind it, which is very crazy. But like, basically what I did was I went and saw how many, I ranked songs based on how many times they've been played live and their spot and their amount of Spotify listens.
Oh my God, so they did this?
So they have a number. So I did that. I did number of times played live times number of Spotify listens, and I have a number. Wow. And so I have this whole, there's like a spreadsheet and stuff to this. Okay. So like I did that, and then I did Room for Squares, every song on there, Continuum, every song on there, and pitted the number one against the number one, number two against the number two.
Yeah.
Kind of, you know, sorry, no, not that. I did number one against like the bottom seed. So I seeded them the way a thing would be
like
seeded.
NBA would be. Yeah, for sure.
So number one versus the least, right? So,
sure.
So a lot of these have buys. Some of the songs have buys, but basically what we're going to do is we're going to go around and we're going to pit songs against each other, and we're going to come up with a champion at the
end. This is fun. All right. This is great.
All right.
Are you ready
for this?
Yeah.
So we're going to start here, and most of these are like a Room for Squares song against a Continuum. I think a couple of them didn't line up that way, but for the most part, they are that way.
Oh, cool. All right. Good, 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 good.
So first songs. Dreaming with a Broken Heart, which is off Continuum, versus 83. Mm. Jeff, you go first. What are you picking?
It's already not fair. I already hate this.
Dreaming with a Broken Heart versus 83.
Song, but, how does 83 go again?
If only my life was more.
Oh like yeah, that's right. Yeah, it's like
whatever happened.
It kind of has that like
it starts out
Nova beat to it. Yeah.
It's got a very Dave Matthews ending in my head.
Yeah.
I have to go with nostalgia, and I have to go with 83.
Ooh, well, I'm picking Dreaming with a Broken Heart.
Oh man, splitting
so so David, it's you. You decide this round because 83 has won, Dreamin' has won.
Yeah, Jeff, I appreciate the nostalgia. I'm a sucker for it, but I loathe songs that are like, if only I was younger. I have to go because I wrote so many of those songs when I was like 23, and I'm like, you know, oh, life was better when I was younger, and I'm like, idiot, you're 23,
you're 23,
you know,
23, right? Yeah.
yeah. So I'm gonna have to go with Dreaming with a Broken Heart.
All right, 83 is gone.
It was kind of like a battle of the best lines for me in my head. Was
sure.
I have to fall asleep with roses in my hand versus whatever
that
happened to my
lunchbox? Oh, dude, that line's so good.
Yeah.
Do I have to fall?
But the lunchbox
with
thing
with
like,
hand?
How come I didn't get a say when that's you threw away all my old toys?
Yeah.
That's
sure.
what made me lean that way.
Yeah.
All right. Next one. I have a feeling which way this is going to go. Neon versus Not Myself. So
which one's Not Myself?
It's the tail
it's
deep, end of
a deep track,
it's a deep cut off of Room for Squares. Would you love me if I'm not myself? In my
Neon takes the cake.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, that's Neon. That's
it's
Neon.
A runaway. But yeah, Not Myself's a good track. It's got a beautiful bridge. I love and I will come around.
It's not
that part.
That is my least favorite song on Room for Squares. So
yeah, you could have taken it or left it, I guess.
Yeah. All right. Next two, we've got Don't Trust Myself. I don't trust myself.
And everyone talks and gives so much praise to the guitar part on Neon, but lyrically it works.
It does. Yeah. It's a great story.
It's not just, it's a great riff. Like that holds up. If you even just read the lyrics on their own, you know, it's dope, you know? So I just want to say credit due where credit's due, you know,
good.
It works.
Definitely noted. All right. Next one. I don't trust myself with Loving You or Great Indoors. So
Continuum is such a better album. It's not even funny.
I know, dude.
I hope no one does this to my work ever. Just when
that's a fair point.
Say a song title and everyone just starts laughing their asses off.
That's a good point. Yeah.
Great Indoors is great, but you know what? I'm going to start it off here. I'm going Great Indoors. What do you think about that, Jeff? You're
just saving face. no, Great Indoors is actually a really good song. Unfortunately, relevant, I guess.
Yeah.
But no, there's no vibe like Trust Myself.
I don't trust myself. Takes the cake. Because I'm pretty sure that was the first single he dropped off of Continuum.
Waiting on the World to Change was the first one.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
That's right.
Okay. Yeah.
Which we'll get to here in a little bit.
I think if you guys saw him live on the Room for Square, when he was touring Room for Squares, he might have played a little bit of Trust Myself on the tour before it became Trust Myself.
But that first live DVD he came out with, I remember he did a really cool intro for... no, that was 3x5. My bad. It wasn't Great Indoors. Yeah.
All right.
Okay, my vote is I don't trust myself.
All right, that's going to go on. I mean, that is what it is. All right, next. These are going to get harder, by the way. I promise you. These are going to get much harder. But
I don't doubt it.
Next one is Belief versus Love Song for No One.
Oh, no. I know what's going to happen here.
David? I say Belief.
Jeff?
I mean, every time I do a sound check, if I'm playing electric on that show... When I'm checking my electric, I play Belief.
It's such a fun riff, dude. It's such a fun riff to play, man.
It's the coolest thing ever. So,
I don't know if I'm the only defender of Love Song for No One on here, but yeah, Belief for sure.
Yeah,
because
you like Love Song for No One. You like
I do like I love the acoustic version from Any Given Thursday, but Belief is probably one of my favorite songs of all time of his. So
yeah.
It's got to be.
Well, Belief definitely is better than Love Song for No One. There's a lot of songs better than Love Song for No One that are not even John Mayer songs. You know how I feel about that song.
You're terrible.
All right. It's well documented how I feel about this song on the podcast.
Yeah, whatever, man. There's some good lyrics in there.
All right. Here we go. Next. Back to You versus In Repair.
Oh, that's a tough one.
Back to You. Which is one of my favorite songs in Room for Squares.
Versus, I'm going to say Back to You.
I'm going to say Back to You too, man. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
That's only a tough one because I feel the same about both of those songs. I feel like they're pretty decent. So that's why it's tough for me.
I like Back to You. In Repair does nothing for me.
Oh, really?
Dude, we're here. We're the same. Yeah. That's, you know, I like it.
I probably would have voted for In Repair because of the instrumental stuff.
Yeah.
It's just more interesting to me.
Next. Heart of Life versus City Love.
That is a hard one. Wow, that's a
everybody
hard one.
Needs Heart of Life right now too.
Heart of Life versus City Love. David, you start it. Heart of Life versus City Love.
Wow, that's a tough one, but I'm gonna go with City Love because that was I remember hearing that for the first time, and you know.
Yeah.
I was like, that's the sexiest thing ever.
You know?
That song for me like separated what Dave Matthews was from what John Mayer was.
Yes.
That song brought this thing of like, oh, this is soul music, you know.
So, cool.
And the solo too is just one of his best.
It's perfect.
I think Angelo and I did we include that in our 10? I'm pretty sure we both did. We both
top
put that
10?
In our
oh,
top
yeah.
10.
That was in my top 10 solos.
Studio solos, yeah. Because it's just such a killer solo. Sexy.
Well, I'm going to go Heart of Life on this one because I really love Heart of Life. So, Jeff, this is you.
Well, there's a grammatical error in Heart of Life, so I feel like I should roll against it.
Are you talking about theirs instead of there are? Yeah.
What are you?
There are. Like, you could easily go there are things. That's it. That's like, just put it in the melody, dude. It doesn't even break up the rhythm of it. Anyway.
That's hilarious. I never thought about that. And both of you are like, oh, are you talking about? Yeah, I know exactly. I'm like, what are you talking about?
Because when you're writing lyrics, you try really hard to not break grammatical rules or whatever.
Yeah.
Unless it's like ain't or whatever, because you can sing ain't. It's not a big offense. But it's a zero offense to that one.
So you know they had a conversation about that then in the studio. They were like, this is not right.
Right? Yeah,
this is not like grammatically genius. Correct, and they were, and he was probably like, "No, we're gonna leave it."
Right. He's just like, "Whatever, man. One take, John. Let's just move on." Heart of Life has a really good message though, and a good melody. So I think I'll go with Heart of Life.
Ooh,
yeah, it's like a
Heart of Life. All right, moves on to the next round. All right, next.
I make that same grammatical error on my song "Bad Days." I say "There's gonna be days" instead of "There are."
Oh, interesting.
There you go.
Yeah, but I definitely hate myself for it. But
it sounds like you and I write similarly when we do lyrics. You're like, God, that lyric just doesn't hit the ear right at all. And it's like the grammatical error of it is just.
Did you think about that, David, when you wrote that? About grammatically?
I did. I think singing it works better for me to say there's going to be days. On page, it looks terrible, you know. But vocally, it's like, but there are gonna be days. It's just too.
But sometimes
like,
that's how we talk, though. That's how I would say it if I was talking. I would say there's gonna be days where.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say there are gonna be days. I would say, the way I would say it is there's gonna be, and that's wrong.
Yeah,
but,
totally. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, totally.
Next, My Stupid Mouth versus Bold as Love.
Oh man, I hate this podcast. I'm leaving.
I gotta go with My Stupid Mouth. I mean, Bold as Love is a Hendrix tune, you know.
Yeah.
I know, but it's such a good cut of that track.
He kills it for sure. But I mean, let's pay homage to the title of your podcast here, you know. So
what are you gonna say, Jeff? Are you gonna go My Stupid Mouth?
I mean, we can't go against My Stupid Mouth because I mean, it's gonna end up winning the whole thing now because of the podcast.
It is definitely not, because you're going to see what it's going up against in a minute. But
oh, no.
So I go My Stupid Mouth, too. And really, I love Bold as Love, but it's the same reason it didn't make my top 10 solos. It's because it's almost not verbatim, but it's so close to Jimi Hendrix's solo that I'm it's great. More, it's amazing. But
it's more of an imitation than
it's just it's him covering it. So, all right. 3x5 versus I'm Gonna Find Another You.
Mm. Oh, good question.
And I'm going 3x5 because this is one of my favorite songs of all time.
Same.
3x5.
Sure.
So I'm going 3x5 on that one.
It's up there with Belief for me.
David? 3x5 versus I'm Gonna Find Another You.
Man, I haven't heard 3x5 in a minute, so... I love that second chord on that chorus so much. I'm going to go 3x5. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. It's like
just for that second chord.
It's like a weird D, C. It's a weird chord. Yeah, it's great.
All right. So what were you going to pick, Jeff? I mean, not that.
Oh, no. Yeah. 3x5. It's up there with Belief is one of my favorite songs of all time.
Stop This Train versus St. Patrick's Day.
Oh, my God.
Let's start out with you, Jeff.
Do you believe this?
What you got?
My dog's asleep during this. I can't believe he's asleep during all this.
Jeff's getting real heated.
I just want somebody in the room to be like, do you see all this?
Do you believe what's happening right now?
Do you believe this happening right now? Stop This Train inspired me to do the podcast, the first podcast for John Mayer. I really love that song, man. It hits real hard. That's one of the realest songs he's ever written up until that point. One of the realest songs he'd ever written. I'll have to go with Stop This Train, man. St. Patrick's Day offers so much. I love the chords in that song, dude.
It goes all over that song.
The chord chart is nuts. Like, if you want to study that song, you're like, what's going on here?
That song's hard. That song is freaking hard to play.
I love it, though. And I love the story he's telling there, too.
All right, so we got Stop This Train from you. David?
Stop This Train.
Yeah, I'm Stop This Train, too. I mean, it's not really... It's kind of not fair at that point.
Yeah.
That's such a good song.
So good, man.
Well, I mean, we've all prefaced that none of these songs are bad.
Of course not.
No, none of them.
All right. We're moving on to round two. So some of the best, the ones that were ranked so high actually already made it to round two. They were buys, all right?
Okay.
So the first one we're going with is Gravity, which was the number one.
Oh, good.
Versus Dreaming with a Broken Heart.
Gravity.
Yeah, Gravity.
Dang. All right. Gravity.
Were you going to vote Dreamin'?
I don't know. I was probably going to say Gravity. But
okay.
I really love Dreamin' with a Broken Heart.
Oh, yeah, me too, for sure.
All right. Next, Neon versus I Don't Trust Myself.
Neon versus Trust Myself? Oh, okay. So this is not a buy round.
This is not a buy round.
Yeah.
Neon versus I Don't Trust Myself.
I'm going to say I Don't Trust Myself.
Oh. I'm going to say Neon, dude.
Yeah, I'm going to have to go with Neon, and it's not just for... I mean, you pointed out the lyrical... I don't know, the lyrical flow of it and how good that song is, as well as the guitar part. Okay. Yeah, so I'm going to go with Neon for sure. Trust Myself is... There's no vibe like that song. I mean, not until maybe Rosie or something.
Yeah. All right. Track. Next round. Why Georgia versus Belief?
Why Georgia is such a classic, man.
It is a classic, for sure.
What are you doing, Dave?
I gotta go Belief.
Belief?
Yeah.
Yeah, Belief.
Oh, Belief. Guys, come on.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me?
Belief has never been more relevant, and it's just
I probably would have said Belief, too, but I just most fun so song. Dirty. Like, just brushing yeah, off dirty. Why Georgia. I mean,
I'm not brushing anything.
That's one of my first loves, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. But
I'm sure a lot of people that live in Georgia are asking why Georgia right now.
But you're not married to your first love, are you?
Well, I guess not.
Yeah.
I guess not.
Call me out there.
We all evolve.
That's true, David. Jeez, little dang it. All right.
All right. Oh, man.
Next round. Slow dancing in a burning room versus Back to You.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about Back to You. That's a good one.
Dun, 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 dun. I'll just go with slow dancing. I mean, it's going to be rare that a lot of songs are going to be able to beat that one. I mean, until this bracket, I guess, until then, whatever the next round is.
But, yeah.
Yeah. That guitar part is one of the coolest things I've ever heard in my life.
Yeah.
So and slow dancing.
And he just makes it sound like when he talks about writing that song, he makes it sound like so like, oh, it's just, I wrote it in a night in the bathroom floor. Like,
oh gosh.
And I'm like, okay, thanks. All right.
Yeah.
Cool.
Thanks a lot.
Cool, John. Appreciate it. Been sitting 6 months on the same lyric, but cool. Good for you.
Yeah. I love Back to You, but it is slow dancing. That one's just better. Okay, here we go. Your Body is a Wonderland, which was number two, by the way. It was the second seed.
It's because it's a hit,
Your Body is a Wonderland versus Heart of Life. And I'm going Heart of Life because...
Yeah, I'm going Heart of Life.
Yeah, there's no question.
It's Heart of Life. All right.
I actually like the guitar part for Your Body's Wonderland. That's a fun one to play.
I will defend Your Body's Wonderland till the day I die. All right.
Yeah. I love the bridge. That, whatever that he's song. Doing, he's playing like a classical kind of guitar part, even though it's not on the classical guitar. But you know where it's he's just playing the two strings and the solo bit. I think that's
I will not defend that song. It sucks.
All right.
Yeah.
There we go. All right.
If you were singing other lyrics, you might, though.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, maybe, yeah.
We've got Vultures versus you forgot about this.
Vultures.
Versus My Stupid Mouth. Vultures versus My Stupid Mouth.
Nah, this is hard. Okay, it's getting hard.
I forgot about Vultures. How dare you?
I'm going to go My Stupid Mouth on this one.
I'm a fake fan. I forgot about Vultures.
The musician in me says Vultures all day, but the boy in me, which I always have to subscribe to the boy, and it goes to My Stupid Mouth.
Yeah. Well, there we go. What were you going
to
say, Jeff?
Yeah, I can't. It's really hard to go against My Stupid Mouth, and it's not just podcast bias. I swear, there's just a way that he's telling that story lyrically and rhythmically and stuff. I don't know how he's doing it. Yeah,
yeah.
It's like mathematician with those lyrics, man. And making it work in the confines of the melody. Salt and pepper shake, or like just the way he's. Yeah.
It's great. I mean, and it's in his first album. It's in his first EP. Like that's one of the first songs he's ever written.
I don't even think he co-wrote that. I mean, because you could attribute quite a bit of like Neon Comfortable success to Clay Cook. You could, because he still plays it.
Yeah.
My Stupid Mouth is all John. He wrote that. You know, that's a solo Johnny boy. Yeah.
All right. Waiting on the World to Change versus 3x5.
I forgot about Waiting on the World to Change, too.
I'm going to go 3x5.
Yeah.
Jeff?
I don't care much for Waiting on the World to Change. I actually have a lyric on my
last
record.
I was about to say Stone Age says that.
Yeah.
It's a great track. Yeah, you have a lyric.
Not only am I calling out everybody, but I'm calling out John specifically.
That's right. I remember that.
Yeah.
I'm tired of Waiting on the World to Change. That's a great song, by the way. Can I vote for Stone Age? No.
Yes.
Yeah. It's 3x5, right? That's the.
Yeah.
I didn't even. Wasn't even paying attention to what Waiting on the World Change was going against. I was just about to vote against it.
Yeah, that's how I am too.
I like again, instrumentally, I think it's a pretty fun song.
The groove is undeniable. Yeah.
Steve Jordan's great on that track.
Steve Jordan's great for sure. It's just contextually, I just can't back it.
I get you.
So it's three. So is it 3x5? Is that what we're saying?
Three,
Jeff?
Yeah.
I think I agree. All right. No Such Thing.
Oh man.
Versus Stop This Train.
Ooh, interesting. Yeah, stop This Train. Dun, 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 that's the first song I ever learned of his on guitar.
I'm gonna have to go nostalgia and go with No Such Thing.
Ooh. No Such Thing.
Even though earlier I was like, I hate when people reminisce about being young, but I'm gonna.
That's a worse offense than 83 is.
I'm gonna contradict myself because I am large. I contain multitudes. All right. So.
I'm gonna go Stop This Train. Sorry, guys.
Cool.
And I'm getting a knock at the door. Talk Uh-oh. Amongst yourselves. Talk amongst yourselves.
No,
knock
I refuse.
At the door. Who answers their door anymore?
I just stand outside. Because mine, I got blinds like right next to my doorway. I'll just stand outside and peek through my blinds. Wait until they get away.
Well, if someone you know is going to be there, they always text you like, hey, I'm here or whatever.
Exactly.
If someone knocks on my door, I clearly don't know you.
Especially now. in COVID times, like, why are you knocking on my door?
Yeah, if you're knocking on my door, I don't know who you are. So I'm not answering, you know. Because if I know you, you sent me a text 15 minutes ago to say that you were on the way, you know.
Right. Or I got a text from the Amazon or from the DoorDash guy that they were coming, right?
Oh, yeah. Did you get some food?
No, that was my four-year-old banging on the door. I'm in my bedroom. It's not my front door.
I thought you meant your front door.
No.
I was judging you hardcore, dude. Like,
no,
who
because
answers their door?
Here's the thing is that if I were to let them knock, if that was my front door, let them knock a couple times and they're gone. My four-year-old? Will not stop.
Oh, they'll keep going.
This is like when I see all the time when we're recording.
Yeah, no, she's funny. The one that runs across the back of the room. So who do we decide? Because I went Stop This Train. David went No Such Thing.
I would stop this train for sure.
Is it stop? All right. Okay, now we're getting it's going to get really hard here. We're at the top eight.
We're getting hard.
Gravity. Gravity versus Neon.
Man, I got to go Gravity all day.
I'm going Neon. So, Jeffrey.
Yeah, that's really tough, man.
You're putting Jeff through like a crisis right now.
Yeah, I'm not gonna be able to sleep now, man. And I gotta work tonight, man.
I like to jump in right immediately and just go the opposite way to put
with the hardest
somebody.
One. I'm gonna do that on the next hardest one.
Put,
I'm just gonna
to
shout
put
out
somebody
my
on the.
Grav and Neon.
Grav and Neon. Gravity could be, objectively, is probably his best song if you asked anyone. Like, if you were to take a poll of, like, regular people, not huge John Mayer fans, but just, like, regular people, look on Spotify, look on all those things, that's the number one song.
Dude, I remember playing that, like, as a joke or something. Or Gravity? Just because I was bored during an open mic or something. It was one of those loose open mics where, like, not a lot of people were there. And I played it, and there were hardly any musical commonalities in the audience. Like, we don't listen to the same stuff.
But
I started playing Gravity,
man.
And everybody was like, woo! And I was like, I looked around like, how does everybody know Gravity?
Everybody knows the song,
so
dude.
Confused.
That's his most famous song.
It's an accessible song, yeah.
So what are you picking? Which way are you going? Are you going to go true John Mayer fan? Neon? Or are you going
to
go regular fan?
I might have to go snobby John Mayer fan and go Neon.
All right, Neon. Ooh, gosh, Neon beat Gravity. All right.
We're going to get a lot of messages about that.
Belief versus Slow Dancing. Belief versus Slow Dancing.
Belief. I just wanted to shout mine out first.
Is it Belief? Oh, my gosh, you guys. Jeez Louise. I would have picked Slow Dancing. Gosh. All right. Heart of Life versus My Stupid Mouth.
Heart of My Mouth.
Heart of Life gets it for me.
Jeff? I'll let you go next.
Oh, thanks. Appreciate you.
Nothing on the line here, so.
That's a good point. Other than, my fan card being revoked. I don't know, by people that care. Heart of My Mouth. I keep saying it. Heart of Life.
Heart of Life. I was
Let's
gonna
just
go.
Do it.
Yeah, yeah, I was gonna go Heart of Life. So
it's just too, man.
That song is so good, man.
It is, man. It's too simple, good a message right now, especially.
It always like hits me hard when I listen to it.
Yeah, it's gonna resonate no matter when you listen to it, and that song is a decade plus old.
Okay, now this one's gonna be really hard for me. 3x5 versus Stop This Train.
You should go first then.
I'll go first. Yeah. Oh gosh. Off the cuff. Oh man. Stop This Train. Oh, I hate that I said that right now.
Man.
But I have to say Stop This Train, because that one actually makes me, like, last time I heard it, I started tearing up during the bridge.
Yeah. When he tells you not to tear up.
Yeah.
That's basically what he's saying lyrically. He's like, hey, don't cry. Everything's cool, because everybody's still there.
Okay, Stop This Train for me. David.
Yeah, man.
Stop This Train.
Dang it.
Gosh.
All right. Well I was going to go with 3x5 just because there's also a relevance to that one, too.
I love 3x5.
It's basically saying, hey, you don't have to Insta everything.
Yeah.
Put your
phone down. Live your life. Put your phone down.
Right.
All right. Final four, Neon versus Belief.
I thought we already did that one. Oh, we did Neon versus Gravity. Yeah. Okay.
Neon versus Belief.
I'm going to say Belief.
Yeah, I'm going to have to go with Belief, too.
Oh.
Freaking crap. Man, I think had Belief not been on Continuum, it you know, just as far as a storyboard goes, you know, when he opens with Waiting on a World Change, and then I think, for me, he really saved, like, the gravity of what was going on with humanity with Belief, you know.
Yeah, I agree with that. It was like he was trying to. It was like on Waiting. He'll rejoin, I think. It was like on Waiting on the World to Change. Like he was trying to figure out what he was trying to. He's trying, you know, dance around what he was trying to say, and then Belief was like, "All right, I figured out what I wanted to say for real."
Yeah, for real.
Roll the tape.
Yeah. And I get it when he showed Columbia Continuum. You know, Waiting on the World wasn't on the record, and they were pretty upset that there wasn't a quote-unquote single on the album.
Oh yeah,
and so he had to go back in and cut Waiting on the World to Change. So who knows? Maybe he just wrote it in like 5 minutes, and that's just how he felt in the moment. But
interesting. So,
but
I didn't know that. But yeah, studios. I always, because I watch and talk about movies so much, I always see studios instead of labels.
Oh sure. Yeah. It's the same thing, yeah.
Yeah, but it's the exact same thing. They answer to the same people, I guess. Artists answer to the same people. But yeah, they'll do that. Man, like, I listen to Jason Mraz, too, and in his second album, his entire first single is about making a single. Because he's like, the studio asked me to do this. Like, he's lyrically saying, the studio asked me to make this song.
Yeah, it's totally. So funny. Yeah, he's talking about, like, the sophomore slump or something.
Yeah,
like
that, exactly. He's like, whatever.
Sarah Bareilles went through the same thing where she, the label wanted her to write a love song. And so that song,
really?
Love song,
so
is,
that,
you I'm could not going to write you a love song.
So
that's
you could be like, oh, she's actually writing that to the label, not.
She's writing that to a label, not to a person, yeah.
That's so funny.
Sure.
That song took off, dude. That was, yeah.
Oh, that's one of the biggest songs in the 2000s, for sure.
What a happy accident. Like, I'm just going to write this out of spite. And then it took off. Oh, oops. My bad.
Oops. Yeah.
What were you, with Belief, what were you, what did you pick?
Oh, I picked Neon.
You did?
Yeah. So it's Belief.
Why do you
hate
John's best songs?
I don't know, man. So last one here. Well, second to last. Heart of Life versus Stop This Train. That's the next one.
I'm going to go with Stop This Train.
Yeah, I'm not going to like the final at all, but Stop This Train.
Okay. That's what I would have said, too.
Well, you can say it.
If I would have just had a platform to say it and a microphone.
That's right.
If I had a microphone
just had a way.
Right now,
that's what I
totally
would have said,
that.
And that's what I did say. All right. Last, here's the final. Belief versus Stop This Train.
That's the final?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's where we're at.
That Belief. Those two made it to the championship.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's right. That's it.
Belief versus Stop This Train. Wow.
Belief versus Stop This Train.
Sometimes it's all about the matchup.
That's great. I go with Belief. I think that is just fate looking us dead in the eye.
Oh man, I'm going Stop This Train. I would have picked. I would have belief made it further than I would have let it make. Like, let it go. So, that's, I mean, crazy, I'm just saying, dude. I picked Slow Dancing over Belief.
If it went up against 3x5, and I would be arguing different.
And yeah. I picked Neon over Belief. So, I'm just saying.
Yeah.
You hate Belief. I get it.
So, so it's up to you, man. What's going to be the winner? Belief or Stop This Train?
I'm feeling Belief a little too hard nowadays, so.
Is that it?
Yeah. Yeah, it's got to be Belief, man.
Okay, well, there we go. Belief, the champion. You see it right there on the screen.
Belief.
Belief, yeah. All right, so we champion. Got it.
Well, Belief is a beautiful armor, man. It is. So.
It is.
Well, fellas, I got 20 minutes before my next.
All right, guys. Thank you so much, David, for being with us. We're going to play a song. You're going to hear a song here in just a second from his new album. But, David, plug your stuff real quick before you go. Where are you at? Where can people find you?
You can, if you just go to Google and type in David Ramirez, I'll be the first one to show up.
Okay.
So anywhere you do that on your phone or iPad or computer, you'll find me.
Instagram.
Instagram is my name, David Ramirez. That's probably where you'll get the most updates. But
All right, man.
Jeff, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming on, dude.
All right.
I became a mega fan over the past week. So.
Oh, I love
it. So this was a really quick dream to come true.
Well, I'm happy to have you in the camp, and I love you guys so much. This has been a blast.
All right, man. Take care. We'll talk to you later.
All right. Adios, guys.
All right. See ya.
See you, man.
See ya.
She's beginning to see it. It's getting pretty obvious. It's no longer a secret. I'm losing confidence. I've had one too many. I should have gone to bed. She's looking right at me. She's in my